So the next speaker for us is Professor C.H. Subramaniam, IIT Hyderabad. His area of research is heterogeneous catalysis, nanomaterials, energy and environment. His key works include conducting polymer reinforced carbon epoxy composite for improved electrical conduction, decoration of plasmonic copper nanoparticles on a support, and single step conversion of methane to methanol assisted by non-thermal plasma. He is expert in plasma related catalysis. So today he is going to talk to us on photoelectrochemical cells, fundamentals and recent advances. It's a very important topic in today's era, especially for the students. So I would like to welcome Professor Subramaniam and with request that you can go ahead with your talk.
Okay, thanks a lot, first of all, for the kind invite. And I must appreciate the organizers for taking such an initiative. I joined in between the earlier talk. I'm sure like all of you probably must have been impressed the way it was explained to you. I'm just going to give the similar connection, but I will be using gold at one or two places. But I will mainly try to concentrate on what exactly these photoelectrochemical cells, okay, so these cells are. And I will be mainly sticking to the basics of it. And okay, so then I will also try to tell you some of the recent advances happening in this area. I mean, I'm sure like this slide, somebody else will also present it. The whole story of it is like now you need to stop using fossil fuels. But everyone says this, my teacher told me, I told the same thing to my students also. But then at one point, somebody puts a question, do you have an alternate? Okay, so yeah, tomorrow we will not use it because we know that CO2 is something which is difficult. Then there are some advances like the earlier talk was. Okay, so but if somebody puts a question, how to stop it? Okay, so is there any methodology to stop it? Okay, or is there any alternate? Nothing, there is no answer to it as of now. But people think that, okay, so if you look at the slide, okay, so initially it was solid fuels. Then in between we have been exhausting the gasoline and petroleum products. But the future are, it is expected that the gaseous fuels for several reasons, let it be handling part or let it be, say, for example, if you say methane you're using instead of, or if you're using CNG instead of, gasoline, then at least like you are not damaging the environment to the extent what the gasoline products will do. Then one question everyone talks about, I'm not going to touch on solar cells, but the reason why I'm flashing this one is plenty of energy is available with sun, everyone agrees to it. And if you look at the whole solar spectrum, which is actually AM1.5, whichever it is. So now we know that there is a small percentage of UV light. Okay, so but majority, the maximum intensity is in the visible region. This is one thing which we can be happy with. At the same time, okay, so we really don't know how exactly to tap this energy. If you really see this, Earth receives close to around 174 petawatts of incoming radiation. And if you think that even if you can tap it, even 10% of it, I think the global energy needs can be actually met. So that's what people say. So then if you look at, there are three traditional ways of tapping the solar energy. Traditional in the sense like they are not truly traditional. So if you look at the very left-hand side, you have the classical photosynthesis. But if you come to the extreme right-hand side, so you have the photovoltaics, okay, so in other words, the PV cells or photovoltaic cells, or in other words, solar cells. But if you actually look at the efficiencies wise, okay, so the whole story of it is you are using the sunlight either to get drive directly the DC voltage in the form of solar cells, okay, or photovoltaics, or you try to get energy, let it be energy can be in the form of glucose or some kind of building blocks, which are like photosynthesis. In the in between, you are actually trying to make some kind of solar fuels. This is the attempt. But if you look at all the three, if I ask a question to many of the students, or many of them are students, which is the most efficient among the three, you may be tempted to say photosynthesis, but if you convert the conversion efficiency of photosynthesis is not greater than 1%. Whereas if on the extreme right hand side, you have the solar cells, which are known to, or which are reproducible efficiencies are more than close to 17-18%. Okay, so let it be in whichever form you're talking about. But in between, you have the fuel generation, so which is like a traditional PEC cells, which mainly works with a semiconductor. So you need a semiconductor for doing this job. Let it be a single particle semiconductor, or the semiconductors can be separated in such a way that, or even the two half reactions can be separated in such a way that, okay, you may need a semiconductor for one of them. The second one can be either a metal or even a semiconductor. So, but if you look at the efficiencies wise, photosynthesis is close to 1%, that's what report, but the entire globe, the energy demands are met only by the photosynthesis. Whereas on the right side, you have the photovoltaics. In between, you are now beating around or you're trying to improve the efficiencies in such a way. If you can directly split water into, say, for example, hydrogen and oxygen, probably this is something which you will cherish. Okay, so you are really dreaming for. This is like a holy grail. But if you classically look at the hydrogen production strategies, okay, even now we are still dependent. If you say that yesterday you're done hydrogenation, let it be through some palladium or whatever be the case, okay, you have used hydrogen bottle or cylinder, that you must have produced actually, or somebody must have done it only through steam reforming of methane. Now, this is the classical way in which it can be done. Whereas though there are close several advances in, especially in thermochemical cycles, this probably has the capacity or expected that it will probably replace steam methane or conventional fossil fuel way at one point. But even other methods, like if you look at electrolysis, okay, electrochemical, so photolysis, all these things are not up to the mark. Then future step can be all these photo steps are closely connected. So that means photoelectrochemical cells, okay. So there is a promise, okay, so which I will explain to you how it is. But if you just look at the overall assessment of hydrogen production, okay, so still we are now, you see that even steam methane reforming is highly efficient compared to other things. Okay, but there is a thermodynamic limit to it. We cannot go beyond that. Okay, so that actually exergy in terms, okay, it comes to close to, still it is the best one. But whereas all other things, which even I'm going to talk, okay, so these things will branch out somewhere here. They will fit somewhere here. There, you're expecting that, okay, they will show efficiency tomorrow at one point. Then some basics on it. I think I'm sure like this slide is known to everyone. So if you need at least like 1.23 volt for splitting water. But then the questions are like this, okay, so if I split water into hydrogen and oxygen, then if I take the hydrogen and actually try to react with oxygen, let it be in fuel cell or let it be in a way of, say, for example, a reaction where you are combining both hydrogen, the reverse reaction, whatever you are doing. So that means how much energy I can drive back. Okay, so then somebody else can also ask a question, sir, this is the basic equation I read in the literature, which actually tells that the heat of formation of water is close to 285 kilojoules. But now you're only talking about a small portion, which is you are only talking. What happens to the rest? If you actually look at the equation carefully, so this equation, though it the heat of formation of this reaction is 285 kilojoules, of that, okay, so the energy that can be derivable is only 237. This is how your delta G0, whatever you represent. But rest of the energy is wasted in the form of a heat. Okay, so that in the form of heat. So that means if you actually look at higher heating value or heat of the formation, which is 285. So that means, in other words, if you tomorrow want to split water. So that means if you split water, the energy what you can derive is only 237 kilojoules that I am putting here. Okay, so water combined with 237 kilojoules, but still I will not be in a position to split hydrogen and oxygen because some energy I have already wasted. Some energy is actually trapped in the hydrogen. Okay, so some heat is trapped. Okay, so that I cannot derive. So that means always I need to put close to 48.6 kilojoules of heat I need to supply every time. So that means splitting of water is not actually as simple as we think, because though everyone says that it is actually whatever, but the Gibbs free energy function or the value just transforms to 1.23 electron volt. This is what we talk about. But actually, if you combine this 48.6, okay, eventually the energy that is needed comes to 1.48 electron volt. That means you call it like the over potential or in the form of, say, for example, some heat that is trapped in hydrogen. Whatever be the case, you can, if you have hydrogen and oxygen, you can only get 237 kilojoules of useful energy. But to get this hydrogen, once again, you need to put, say, for example, okay, so 285 kilojoules of energy. So that means probably I have conveyed the message that splitting of water on equation or on paper, it appears to be very simple, but it doesn't go the way we think. Then what do you mean by this one? How nature is doing this one? To cut short it, nature does this in a very simple way, but it doesn't take place in one particular fashion. They are two different reactions. Photosynthesis is actually a very complex reaction, because you look at here, hydrogen is a gas. Okay, so hydrogen is, water is basically a liquid, and your CO2 is a gas. Okay, so then you have a solid component, or there's a leaf is kind of a semi-solid kind of a component. That means you have a three-phase reaction taking place, which are very, very complex to think. But to simplify it, you can put it in two steps. The reaction that is taking place in the presence of light, the reaction that is taking place in the absence of light. between the two, that means the water and the CO2, the sluggish one is CO2. I mean, thanks to the previous speaker, probably I'm sure like you would have impressed all of you. CO2 is more sluggish compared to water. So that means water splitting is the only one that takes place in the presence of light. This is a visible reaction. This is the light reaction. That happens, if that happens, then what happens is like you get oxygen out, okay, oxygen evolution takes place, but the hydrogen, whatever you have, that gets actually trapped in, say, for example, in the system. So that means that I don't want to see the hydrogen evolution for an effective artificial photosynthesis. My job is basically to split water, so then I need to supply, say, the CO2. So that means I need to make sure that the reaction which is given outside the loop, that reaction has to actually take place. So that means I worry about water splitting in the presence of light. Okay, so then I remove oxygen, I don't worry about it. But the proton reduction is something which I'm not really interested. Whereas now the actual reaction which you look at here, this is the only reaction. If at all you look at, I may show you at one point, there will be energy balances, okay, or the efficient, or I will tell you the feasibility of this one. This reaction definitely is a feasible reaction. That means if somebody talks about artificial photosynthesis, okay, taking clue from PEC cells, you may be thinking that, okay, so are you, I'm sure like by this time you have understanding that I'm splitting water to get hydrogen. This hydrogen should do the CO2 hydrogenation. But the CO2 hydrogenation is as complex as, okay, listed here. Okay, so I'm sorry, I was not there for the previous throughout the talk. But if you look at here, if you want to really reduce CO2 to whichever form you want, all these forms are, say, for example, you say endothermic or not feasible, whichever way you want, you can think it. But the E0 of this reaction is very, very negative for all these half cells. The only reaction which you can think of it basically is like, okay, so or if you look at the way you are actually trying to supply the electrons, so the severity of this reaction, you are decreasing it. That means pure CO2 activation is not a feasible thing. Then the CO2 in the presence of, say, for example, acidic medium, you have 2 electron transfer to formic acid. Okay, better. Compared to that, you have, say, for example, 4 electron reduction to formaldehyde. Okay, so then when compared to that, you have, see, for example, this 8 electron reduction giving you, say, for example, the complete reduction. This actually has very, very least energy requirement. So that means that the reactions appear to be simple. Okay, so on paper, but the way the nature is doing, okay, so it's a very complex way. But still, there is a hope that, okay, if you look at classical photosynthesis, you have carbon dioxide plus water, okay, giving you, say, for example, glucose molecule plus oxygen out. The same way tomorrow, if somebody coins a term like artificial photosynthesis, you actually look at the green leaf is now replaced with a semiconductor. Okay, so then more question is like, did we identify a suitable semiconductor that can probably or has a potential to replace the leaf? Okay, this is something which $1 million question, which nobody has an answer for it. Then believe that, okay, so if you know how to split water into hydrogen and oxygen, this oxygen just goes into the atmosphere. Okay, so I'm not worried for this one, but this hydrogen is something which I'll make use of it. Okay, as I said that I don't want even to reduce it to totally hydrogen. I don't want to see even hydrogen evolution. I want this way nature is doing. Nature doesn't leave hydrogen molecule. Otherwise, nature would have been totally with hydrogen. Okay, because if you look at the classical equation, you get 2 moles of hydrogen with respect to 1 mole of oxygen in the photosynthesis. But hydrogen is not released. So that means that, okay, you need to know how to split water efficiently, the first step of it. If you don't split even water, there is no question of even any of the studies. If you split water, then the second step of the reaction is like, how do you ensure that the CO2 hydrogenation basically in situ takes place? Let it be in the form of glucose, maybe, say, for example, in the final one, your wish list. Even if you get methane, the way it is shown, I think it is something like which people will cherish. But this is not actually, I'm talking about for the first time, or this is not all of you are hearing for the first time. So this is actually a classical strontium titanate catalyst. The moment you shine the light, just put a 1 beaker reaction. It's a single pot reaction kind of a thing. 2 half reactions like oxygen and hydrogen evolution, both are taking place. You see the bubbles. This is actually the way in which it was represented. The earliest discovery was by Fujishima and Honda. This was dates back in, say, early 70s. That means that you need to have, say, for example, you want to tap the sunlight. So then you need to have a suitable anodic material which creates now the charge separation between them. The way solar cells somebody talks about, it's exactly the same thing. Just don't worry about it. I'm talking about photoelectrochemical cells. That's the only difference. Otherwise, now the anodic reaction generates electrons in the conduction band. These things will be transported, okay, so towards the cathodic side where now the reduction reaction is going to take place. So that means you need to have two half cell reactions which are actually separated in this case. Then if you look at now, if you look at the literature now, the combinations of the photocatalyst people used are basically like you have, say, for example, the D0 configurations, which are with respect to TiO2, or even D10 configurations, which are with respect to zinc oxide. These two appear to be the promising combinations in the literature. You may ask a question, sir, periodic table has several elements. Also, I know that this 1.23 volt, okay, if I look at in the literature, this 1.23 volt in the Sevlar spectrum, I need to have 1000 nanometer radiation. So that means, like, why do I worry about it? Okay, I have the sufficient radiation present in the sunlight. Then you need to worry about a semiconductor. Can I not look at any material which is a colored one? Because any colored material typically absorbs the sunlight. Now, these things, combinations will not work definitely. That's also the reason why even now people are beating around only, or people are using heavily TiO2 in solar cells. The very reason is that, okay, so the D0 configurations are probably, they're kind of inert on D10 and D0, that zinc oxide and TiO2 are the best combinations. But we all know that these two, all if you look at other semiconductors, say for example, in this case, people may talk about tungsten oxide as listed there, or even iron oxide. Tungsten oxide probably is in the large band gap semiconductor. But if you look at now the iron oxide, okay, so iron oxide doesn't do the hydrogen evolution because the conduction band position is not suitable with respect to the hydrogen evolution. That means if you come to the left hand side bottom picture, this is the ideal representation, you should worry about it. So that means the first combination listed there, this can do both oxygen evolution and hydrogen evolution. Whereas the last combination you have, okay, so that will neither do the oxygen evolution nor the oxygen evolution, neither the hydrogen evolution. That means these two can only do one of them, like both will not be done. So that means ideal combination I can have is only this way. Then you transform it to the right hand picture. Okay, so TiO2 can do the job, zinc oxide can do, CDS also can do. But to know, then one should answer why CDS cannot be used. Then zinc sulfide is basically kind of an insulator. That means strontium titanate can do. That means though there are various combinations, literature, everything cannot be done. Everything cannot be used. The very reason is this one. Normally, if you shine the light on a semiconductor, okay, so then the excitation is a very, very fast process. Then what I want, the electron which is present in the conduction band should not react with my hole which is present in the valence band. That means this is called the recombination. My job is to prevent the recombination. But if you look at now the time scales of this, the recombination is a very highly dominant reaction. The recombination competes heavily with respect to the hole which can do the oxidation or the reactions of the hole. Whereas now the electron transfer reactions are very, very sluggish. Now you look at this is of the order of 10 power minus 3 seconds, whereas now the recombination is a very, very dominant reaction. Let it be solar cells or let it be followed to electrochemical cells. Your job is now how to separate the excitons. That means how to create the excitons. For that, you need suitable radiation. Then how do you separate them? That means the charge separation has to take place. That's the reason why you should not have a small band gap semiconductor. So you need to have a wide band gap semiconductor. Then the question is like how to make sure that now the charge transport is taking place. You see the electron transfer is sluggish compared to recombination. Now your job basically comes with respect to, so that means here comes the advantage of probably nanomaterials, where now the recombination, okay, probably can be prevented by making the particle in the nano form, where by this way, you can actually prevent now the surface recombination as well as volume recombination. So that means you are preventing. But this is one part which is making in nano. But the other possibilities of basically preventing the recombination is like you try to dope with a metal. Okay, so like you decorate or dope or whichever way, like they're very closely related. It's not very easy to ensure that whether metal is really dope or not unless you prove it with some kind of XRD, which is actually a retwheeled refined one. But otherwise, if you see that TiO2 is colorless, the moment you try to dope something, if it takes up some color, then it actually tells that there is some bulk oxide which is actually present there. In other words, you can do metal doping. Otherwise, you can also do non-metal doping, like the way people talk about combustion synthesis, these things where you are also trying to dope nitrogen and say, for example, carbon. In place of, say, for you are only modifying the molecular orbital picture in these cases. So by that way, you are shifting this one to the visible radiation, or because TiO2 is around 3.2 electron, or taking clue from the nature, okay, so try to combine, okay, so the way nature is doing, combine with the dye, okay, so which is a small band gap semiconductor, which quickly pumps the electrons if the suitable. The whole story of this one is basically is as simple as to understand. Now the conduction band of the semiconductor, whichever, or die in this case, or the LUMO of the semiconductor, LUMO of the die in this case, should be more negative with respect to your conduction band. And now say, for example, okay, so that's the only requirement I have it here. Then the electron will be quickly transferred to the conduction band of my TaO2. Or in other words, you can also go with the small replacement, or the easiest replacement you can think of is take a quantum dot like CDS. Then you may ask a question, CDS also has 2.5 electron volt band gap compared to say, for example, 1.23. Then why I cannot use CDS directly? The question is very valid. But main problem with the sulfides is, especially sulfides are known to undergo photocorrosion. So that means that's also the reason why also preparing sulfides, okay, at room temperature, you need some tedious conditions. Okay, then after you prepare it, they are known to undergo, photocorrosion. That's why you need to use either a sacrificial or you need to use some kind of suitable, electrolyte combination. That means if you look at now, these are the only four combinations where whoever talks about it, there are only four combinations. Put a metal doping, put a non-metal doping, you take a small band gap semiconductor or you replace it with the die. Now you say that, okay, fine, sir. Now I want to know that how is it done practically? If you look at left-hand side, it's photocatalysis. If you look at right-hand side, it's PEC. The only difference in this case is in the left-hand side, it's a single particle catalysis where both the reactions are being done by the same particle. Whereas you come to the right-hand side now, the photoelectrochemical, so that you are actually trying to separate them. That means you have anodic reaction, you have cathodic reaction, you have the electrolyte, you have the charge transfer. All these things are the complexing ones in this case, or the complex ones in this case. But you never worry about these things when you actually look at photocatalysis. That means actually the photos, this I have already told you, if you look at photo electrochemical water splitting now, that means you need to worry about the charge generation. Then you need to separate it. You need to make sure that the transport takes place, and then you need to ensure that, okay, the charge, okay, so carrier, transfer, the electrolyte interface also takes place. So then finally it is ready at the cathodic site where the electron comes from the external circuit, where there will be a reduction that is taking place. So these reactions, I have to worry about it, okay, so in all these combinations. Then the ideal combination, the way it is shown in the right hand side picture, the band gap, though people talk about 1.23, the ideal band gap is around 2 electron volt. So then I must ensure that, okay, so now this is my semiconductor. The semiconductor conduction band should be more negative with respect to the hydrogen evolution level. At the same time, the valency band, in other words, the whole creation position, should be more positive with respect to, say, for example, oxygen evolution level. So that means if you look at now your two fingers, okay, you put it and, okay, so in the right-hand side, you make a bigger picture. So the, in other words, like you are actually trying to sandwich your hydrogen-oxygen evolution reaction within the banded positions of your conduction, now with the semiconductor. So this is how basically you can do. Then these are the latest combinations which people think of. If you look at, okay, the combinations like the Cu2O, which actually reported to be promising, TaO2 combination with Cu2O, or this kind of combination, so they appear to be very, very promising. The solar to hydrogen conversion efficiency, people reported it as a good value. Otherwise, if you look at here, even simple gallium arsenide, okay, so that cannot even do the oxygen evolution reaction. So that means sticking to the small band gap semiconductors that can be combined with the TaO2, these are the options you have, okay, which can work. This you can operate in a single cell mode or even a combined cell mode. That means two half cells, you can separate it. For photoanodic reaction, you need to have an N-type semiconductor. So then you need to have actually a P-type semiconductor as a photocathode for, say, for example, the hydrogen evolution reaction. Another complex thing what you find is basically the suitable electrolyte combination, because the moment you put, say, for example, a semiconductor in the electrolyte, okay, so then at the interface, now the complex phenomena can take place, because depending on the type of the electrode you are talking about, okay, so the P type, which is for the cathodic, and N type, which is for the anodic, the moment you put an electrolyte, so there has to be an alignment of your, the Fermi level. For this to happen, now the band bending has to take place, okay, for N type semiconductors, the bending will be in the upward direction. For a P-type semiconductor, the bending will be in the downward direction. Okay, so depending on the combinations you are choosing it with respect to the electrolyte, now you see that the open circuit potential is something like, which is actually a crucial thing. So which you need to worry about a suitable combination. So that means that the charge transfer process at the interface results in the generation of the potential gradient. This is basically in the space charge region across the interface that leads to the bending of the bands, okay, so which is upward for the N-type and downward for P-type. And if the Fermi level of an n-type semiconductor is above the initial electrolyte redox potential, so then the electrons will flow from n-type semiconductor to the electrolyte. So this is one thing. So then, as I said, that these two, you can separate the half cells, or you can do it in the tandem mode, the way it is shown. These are dual, photoelectrode combination, where you have both an n-type and p-type reactions taking place in the same cell. So that means p-type semiconductor, so now which drives actually the majority of them are holes. Okay, so n-type basically the electrons. When n and p are actually used together to form a junction, now the story goes little more complicated, because now the charge transfer resistance also comes in the picture. So the electrons in the n-type semiconductor migrate to the p-type. Okay, so they have to leaving holes. So then the oxygen evolution takes place at the photoanode, and the hydrogen evolution takes place. In all these things, now the advances, you can propose it, or you can work towards improvements based on three factors. One is the light harvesting. Thanks to the earlier speaker, I'm sure like the plasmonic effects he must have probably explained. So now those plasmonic effects, you can ensure that light absorption cross section, you can increase it. Okay, so that you can improve this one. Then once if you generated the excitons, okay, so ensure that, okay, their separation is taking place, then the respective catalytic reactions have to take place. In all these cases, you see that you have two electrodes, okay, believe that both are semiconductors, okay, you have two electrodes you are worrying about. So then the electrolyte combination, then the suitable positions of the bands is something like which is interesting. So this is something you have to do. Then I'm sticking to the anodic reaction for time being, because anodic reaction is the kickstart of the reaction. Okay, so then the subsequent reduction will be done at the cathode, but the initiation of this cell basically takes place through the anodic part. Okay, where the efficiency can be improved. Okay, so by either doping, or you can actually make use of metal plasmonic effect, or in the plasmonic effect, or you can also go with the co-catalyst combination, or many times people also think about something like a junction solar cells. Okay, so just the semiconductor engineering is something which is not an easy thing. You can talk about it easily, or is not an easy thing to understand. You can talk at a great length, but even now if you say that I want to produce a single crystal, okay, so then people don't know how quickly to do it. Okay, they know how to do it, but this is not kind of an economical. So then once again, controlling the thickness is one part. So the bulk semiconductor engineering is something like, which is not very, very easy. Then the semiconductor morphology, this is also that's also the reason why I asked that question to the previous speaker. Many a time, actually, if I ask you to write an FCC picture, you take actually a cube and you try to put a sphere. Okay, so because you know that the spherical morphology is the minimum energy configuration. Whenever you are trying to form a material, sphere is the one that is preferred in the open, or in other words, if you don't vary conditions too much, then more or less you end up with some kind of a spherical particle. Unless you are intentional, you want to really control the morphology the way nature is doing, or the way enzymes do. Okay, so we cannot really control them. So that means that the morphology control also something which you can expect it. But the metal doping, people do it heavily. So for doping is one part, okay, so which actually people think the mid states whichever you are creating between the valence and conduction band, so probably can actually enhance or minimize the recombination. Okay, so this is one part which people can think. The one example in the literature which you can find is like if you look at bismuth vanadium oxide, okay, so if you look at now the pristine oxide, okay, so normally bismuth compounds are known to be thermoelectric materials. But the way it shows the current close to zero, or the current density close to zero, actually tells that this is not a thermoelectric material. The pristine oxide, okay, shows some efficiency, some current. So, but whereas now, if you look at now, the more the molybdenum, the moment you put it, okay, it's not actually kind of doping, because you cannot dope 8% molybdenum. So that means the way you try to anchor, okay, so with respect to the earlier speaker's answer, now you have typically close to improvement in the efficiency is expected. But still, if you see that the incident photon conversion efficiency, if you look at now, majority of the conversion is basically essentially taking place in the less than 500 nanometers. That means part of the energy is actually wasted. But whereas if you shift the absorption cross section or absorption region towards more visible region or towards NIR region, so then probably one can expect actually improvement in the efficiency. That's where actually you can also try to go with some kind of a co-catalyst loading. The co-catalyst loading basically is to accelerate the water splitting reaction. So it provides the active sites for redox reaction. Okay, so it is also used to reduce the over potential. Because if you look at now, the 1.23 volt is something which I'm always keeping in the mind. But it doesn't split unless I supply 1.48 or 1.49 volt. Okay, so the reason in this case basically is that the oxygen over potential. So the role of co-catalyst sometimes is also to decrease the over potential is one. This is one. But still, there are actually some limitations in understanding and optimizing it. So then you can also load a co-catalyst combination. Okay, so you can take the help of say bismuth sulfide. Okay, so these kind of combinations. The reasons are that the absorption section is basically pushed into the more towards the NIR region, or it actually covers the total visible region. In this effect, okay, the plasmonic nanoparticles, which one people advocate always heavily. But in this case, I have this slide. Okay, thanks for this slide. Normally, whenever you talk about basically a plasmonic combination, whichever you are talking about it. So first and foremost, you need to worry about the Schottky barrier, because the moment you put actually metal nanoparticle on semiconductor surface, there is a Schottky barrier which is actually developed. Okay, so you can, so now that means when, but the advantage part you think of it is like there can be an improved or near field enhancement is something which you can always exploit it. Or in other words, like there can be actually hot electron injection, because the layers which are present below the surface layer can also get activated with respect to the far field scattering. So that then you also have some kind of a phenomena which is kind of a hot electron injection, especially whenever your particle size is around of the order of tens of nanometers. Especially in the case of gold, if it is less than 20 nanometers, you can actually see the hot electron injection. Okay, so then you can also, then the most common thing or most advocated thing people can think of is the localized plasmon resonance energy transfer is something which you can also make use of it. That means if you typically put a plasmonic nanoparticle on, say, for example, some semiconductor surface, so now the nanoparticle in contact with the semiconductor, the plasmon energy you can extract in two ways. One is a radiative energy transfer, radiative damping. Another one is an unradiative damping. The population of surface plasmons that decay via radiative damping will be converted into the photons, whereas a non-radiative decay will be converted, say, for example, to create some additional electron hole pairs within the nanoparticle. So that means that as far as plasmonic enhancement, three main characteristics you can think of it with respect to water splitting. The light trapping, that means the scattering enhancement. Okay, so that means more energy is trapped or more energy is absorbed. Okay, so more solar radiation, more sunlight energy is absorbed. Then you can also think of the, depending on the particle size, you can think of hot electron injection is something which people are talking nowadays. You can also think that the plasmon resonance energy transfer, okay, so that basically this is the fashion. I told you that one is a radiative, another one is a non-radiative decay. So this is what actually I told you that, okay, so the light scattering, this actually improves the absorption cross-section. It can enhance the effective optical path length in the semiconductor due to the scattering of photons back and forth in semiconductor, back to the semiconductor. So this leads to the corresponding enhanced absorption, and in addition to that, the generation of charge carriers. Depending on the particle size, you think of hot electron. So with respect to this, the gold is something like which people always advocate it. In fact, you see that whenever you look at even Ba2S3, okay, so that Ba2S3 basically say that this is also not a thermoelectric material. But the moment you try to put some kind of, say, the gold nanoparticles, which are of the order of around 8 to 10 nanometers, then actually you can see that it's a combined plasmonic effect. At the same time, you can also see that the improved efficiency can also be due to, this needs to be proved with respect to the lifetime. Okay, so if you prove it, then the hot electron injection can also take place the way it is shown in this picture. Then the typical conversion efficiencies of the order of around 4-5 something, which you can always expect it. So then the light concentration through PRET, okay, so this is one which I've already said this. Plasmonic nanoparticles with large absorption cross-section can act as efficient light concentrators. So then your improved light absorption and the nanoparticles near field energy, okay, say radiatively transferred to the semiconductor. And hence, okay, so you can facilitate, electron hole pairs in the semiconductor. In PRET process, the surface plasma resonance of the nanoparticles can enhance the electric field strength, okay, so on the surface, or electric field intensity on the surface of the semiconductor. And both effects have the ability to promote the one, as you remember, I told you mainly three factors. You try to create the charge separation. At the same point, this is not the end of the story. If you try to create the charge separation, the easiest thing what can happen is they try to recombine. My job is to ensure that they don't recombine with each other. So this is something which you can do by creating some kind of trappings, especially the advantage when you have with the gold nanoparticle or this kind of small nanoparticle. One is your SPR effect. the SPR effect can lead to two distinct effects. Okay, either it can be to improved absorption capacity, or in other words, it can actually create several electron hole pairs, or it can transfer the energy, the non-radiative way the energy can be transferred. This is one part. In addition to that, the separation will be, the recombination will be, to some extent, it will be minimized. This you can easily prove it with the PL spectra, especially with take cedium. Cadmium sulfide is the most advocated one. If you take cadmium sulfide and if you try to look at the lifetime measurement, at the moment you put actually a nanoparticle, a metal nanoparticle of a very small size of 10 to 20, 30 nanometers, then actually you can see that, okay, so the lifetime, with the lifetime studies, you can understand that, okay, so the recombination is to some extent prevented. So then here in this particular study, in one of the recent studies, actually people try to look at tungsten oxide. Please understand the way I'm choosing the example today, tungsten oxide, which is not known for hydrogen evolution. Say bismuth vanadium oxide, which is actually not known for hydrogen evolution because the conduction band positions are not suitable with respect to the hydrogen evolution level. But now that can be pushed, okay, so that can be improved, okay, so the hydrogen evolution capacity actually can be improved due to these effects, which are actually reported to be due to the Pratt enhancement in this case, where the tungsten oxide, okay, so in the dark, okay, so if you look at the way it is shown here, so it is clearly not actually doesn't show any current density, but in the presence of light, okay, some improvement. That improvement is actually the enhancement can be seen whenever you dope with, say, for example, gold. Some specific notation they have given it, or the authors have given it. But in both the cases, now you see that, okay, the moment, let it be in the molybdenum in the one of the earlier cases, or even in this case, basically gold. So in these cases, people expect that the improvements are mainly due to the Pratt effects, or even it's due to the minimization, the recombination, or to some extent, the recombination is prevented in these cases. So then if you look at now the conversion efficiencies, okay, so typically the conversion efficiency is not very great, but the materials are not actually very, very expensive in this case. But in some cases now, the conversion efficiency reported is up to, say, for example, 10 to 11% solar to, the hydrogen conversion efficiency. So then if you just continue, try to understand the heterojunctions, the heterojunction is one part which all of us can easily think of it. Say, for example, try to take, say, for example, small band gap semiconductor, and actually you try to put it on a large band gap semiconductor with the matching energy level positions. Then actually you can think of it like the heterojunction can be created. The heterojunction consists of an electron accepting semiconductor and a hole accepting semiconductor. So depending on the combinations you need. So then the interface formed at the junction, due to the difference in the direction of the electron or the hole movement, there will be the interface is something which you need to always play with it. You need to always choose the suitable combination. The existence of the interface with varying charges may lead to the formation of an internal electric field at the junction, which may induce the separation of the photogenerated electron hole combination, resulting in the reduced, kind of recombination. The efficiency of the heterojunction system for water splitting depends on their appropriate band gap. So as I said that, if you look at CDS TaO2, CDS is 2.5 electron volt, whereas TaO2 is 3.2 electron volt. But now the way the conduction band positions are placed, okay, so now you can easily expect that the electron transfer from the conduction band of, say, for example, CDS to the conduction band of your TaO2. So that means the band gap is one part which you need to, very small band gap is not going to do any job, okay. But if you look at metal has a different effect, with, as I explained earlier. So you need to worry about the band gap, you need to look at the alignment, and you need to also look at the stability of the material. At the end of the story, you also need to worry about the electrolyte combination, because whenever you use sulfide, so that means like, okay, sulfide electrodes, okay, you need to always worry about some kind of a system which actually minimizes the hole reactions. Otherwise, the photocorrosion actually can take place. So the heterojunction, using it, the benefits can be that, okay, it enhances the efficiency, so especially like the electron hole separation. Then it increases the lifetime, okay, so of the interfacial charge transfer, okay. So then the heterojunction has a staggered band alignment and create a built-in potential, which actually facilitates the charge separation. And it can also sometimes broaden the visible light, okay, so absorption capacity of it. So now within this context, okay, so the bismuth sulfide, okay, Ba2S3 combination was actually tested with the tungsten oxide, okay, say for example, then they expected that, okay, some improvements are reported in the recent past, and they have very good appreciable, or they have appreciable conversion efficiencies. If you actually look at here, Ba2S3 is typically around 1.4, 1.5. The advantage in this case is, like, if you look at now, tungsten oxide is close to 2.8. But BA2S3 is basically 1.4, 1.5. This is mainly towards the NIR region or towards the less than 770 or less than 780 nanometers of the radiation. That means you have increased now the, you are trying to tap the energy which is otherwise not being used by the semiconductor. This is one thing which actually people try to use it. So then the good efficiencies are the good representative, things are reported in the literature. But ideally speaking, that okay, though I try to impress all of you with, say, for example, plenty of things can be done. But ideally speaking, say, for example, if you have a tandem cell or if you have, because if you look at now the artificial photosynthesis, the whole job of it is like your proton, whatever you have, that should not, I don't want to see the hydrogen evolution there. But now you have a situation where on one side of the electrode or one side of the cell, you have now the water splitting takes place. Now you have a medium which actually transports my proton. Now if I'm in a position to send my CO2 or actually send or facilitate now the CO2, then if I'm in a combination to, if I'm in a combination which actually favors now the CO2 reduction in situ, if you look at now the way I've shown the equation, okay, so this is the equation I'm talking about. So if you look at now the combination, I'm talking in this case, I actually got now the H+. Now if I'm trying to send it with the CO2 or the CO2 reduction in the presence of now the proton which is present there, depending on, say, for example, this is typically like a 4-electron reduction we expect in this case. So then if not to glucose, maybe you are in a position to convert it basically to, say, for example, some kind of, useful materials. So this can be the near, the immediate thing which people can think of it is, you have a combination where the water splitting takes place on shining the light. This is a light reaction which you want. Then I want to split water basically to get, say, for example, my oxygen evolution is done. But anyway, now the proton, I'm not really interested to look at. But now here, if I bubble now my CO2, so the CO2 is now anyway sluggish. You cannot directly make it reactive. But in situ, if the CO2 reduction takes place, because now I have 4 electrons which are readily available, there are basically the 4 protons which are readily available for me. So that means if you induce this reaction through CO2 reduction, okay, so then some of the job is actually, part of the job is automatically done. So that means the crux of the whole story is like you need to improve the cross-section or absorption cross-section. For this, you can make use of the suitable combinations or you combine with a small band gap semiconductor, or in other words, you can make use of the plasmonic effect. Then the second part of then the you or otherwise use a very small junction solar cell like in the previous case it was shown. So like in the previous case it was shown where now the absorption is pushed towards NIR region. So this is one thing which actually you can expect it. Then the second part of it, the charge separation which is taking place, and the third part of it is the electrolyte, which is actually the one which you are playing with. The electrolyte electrode interface is something like which is now controlling the total reaction of it. So I think this is just the basics of what exactly the PEC cell, how it is going to be. I stop here and I will be happy to take up any questions that you may have in this regard.